So let's start with the introduction. So pulmonary hypertension refers to elevated pressure in the pulmonary circulation that are caused by either pulmonary vascular remodeling and inflammation or increased pressure known as pre-capillary or post-capillary pulmonary hypertension. Its prevalence is around 15 to 50 patients per million in Europe and United States. Different types of pulmonary hypertension can require different treatment, but all forms of pulmonary hypertension are serious and can be life-threatening. This is a very beautiful paper from Lancet Respiratory Medicine Journal, published in 2016. It's about the prevalence of pulmonary hypertension globally. So there are three kind of areas like red, yellow and green. So green areas are high prevalent, green areas are countries where the high prevalence of pulmonary hypertension, and the yellow are the area where the prevalence is medium, and oranges are the area where the prevalence is low. And the 80% of the population with PH are from developing countries. It is due to lung diseases, heart diseases. And one beautiful paper at Kerala Registry by Dr. Hari Krishnan in India about the pulmonary hypertension. This tells about 48 per million adult population belongs to pulmonary hypertension. Now coming to the groups of pulmonary hypertension. There are five different groups of pulmonary hypertension that are based on the causes. Group 1 is pulmonary hypertension. It is known as PAH. So there is a lot of confusion what is PAH and what is pulmonary hypertension. So pulmonary hypertension is totally divided into 5 groups. Group 1 is known as PAH. So I am going to discuss about this therapy in PAH group. So these are the 5 groups. Group 1 includes like about 9 entities, including the idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension, heritable PH due to BMPR2 and other gene mutations, drug-induced and toxic-induced PH, and PH due to CTD-associated HIV infection, schistosomiasis, portal hypertension, congenital heart disease, and pulmonary vascular occlusive diseases, pulmonary capillary hemangiomatosis, and persistent pulmonary hypertension of newborn. These classes and these groups comes under the group 1 PH. This is known as PAH. And the group 2, which is the most common kind of type of PH, is due to left heart disease. Group 3 is due to the lung diseases like ILD, COPD, and the other diseases which can lead to hypoxia. And group 4 is TCTE PH and other pulmonary artery obstruction. This is a revised classification from 2022 ESC/ERS guideline. And group 5 includes due to the multifactorial mechanism like hematological disorders, some thyroid disorders, systemic and metabolic disorders. These are the common drugs which are associated with pulmonary hypertension. So aminorex, fenfluramine, dextroamine, and there are some possible causes like cocaine abuse and some alkylating anti-cancer drug like alkylating agent and bisotinib. So these are the drugs which can cause pulmonary hypertension. So pulmonary hypertension is a very complex disease because it is a pathophysiological disorder that may involve multiple clinical conditions that may be associated with a variety of cardiovascular and respiratory diseases. And the complexity of its management requires a multifaceted, holistic and multidisciplinary approach with active involvement of patient with PH in partnership with clinicians like cardiologists, pulmonologists and physicians. Little bit about historical background of PH. So first description was given by von Romberg in 1891, and then after that first human right heart catheterization was done by Forsman on himself in 1929. His two students, Conrad and Richard, go through this, and they have received Nobel Prize in Physiology in 1956 because they have studied a lot about pulmonary circulation. In 1951, Drysdale described some case series of PH. And in 1960, it was a very remarkable year, or maybe worse year, because at that time, pulmonary hypertension epidemic was happened due to the aminorex, the anorexic agents. After that, the consensus was made. The first World Symposium was happened in 1973 in Geneva, Switzerland. They defined classical and historical definition of pulmonary hypertension on basis of right heart catheterization. So they defined pulmonary hypertension when the mean pulmonary artery pressure is more than equal to 25 millimeter of LG. After that, the recent in 2018 in Nice, France, the 6th World Symposium was happened, and they cut down this value up to 20 millimeter as of these. Now the new definition is mean pulmonary arterial hypertension is more than 20 mmHg. Why this happened? Because they have seen in multiple registries and multiple data, the pressure in between 20 to 24, they have a progressive disease, and they have a greater mortality and morbidity. So they have reduced this value from 25 to 20. Normal pulmonary artery pressure is about 14 plus minus 3.3 mmHg. So the two standard deviation value has been taken as a pulmonary hypertension. MPAP is more than 20. So this is on the right side, this is a pathological form of pulmonary hypertension artery. It is an intimal fibrosis, endothelial proliferation, and medial thickening, smooth muscle cell hypertrophy, and hyperplasia. So now recently in 2020, the ESCRS guideline for the diagnosis and treatment of pulmonary hypertension has been published, and there are a lot of changes in the definition, management, and risk stratification criteria also. So now coming to the one more point included in this definition is pulmonary vascular resistance. Initially it was more than 3, but now it is more than 2 Wood's units. So pH is defined as mean pulmonary artery pressure more than 20 mmHg. Pre-capillary pulmonary hypertension was defined by mean pulmonary artery more than 20. Pulmonary artery wedge pressure by right heart pressure less than equal to 15 mmHg. And pulmonary vascular resistance more than 2 Wood's unit. Post-capillary or isolated post-capillary or due to the left heart diseases, pulmonary hypertension is due to where all two things were same, but only pulmonary artery wedge pressure more than 15 mmHg. And they have also included the exercise period definition, also included in this new guideline. So what are the challenges with this new definition? Old definition was the basis of all treatment trial, because all the trials included the old definition of pulmonary hypertension. Now our definition is new, criteria has been changed, but still we are having the same drugs and same trials. There is no new, maybe new trials are going on, but with the new definition, but the old trials which we have, the basis is only old definition. So we don't know how to treat patient with MPAP between 20 and 24 millimeter of LG. New definition may lead to overdiagnosis and overtreatment for pulmonary hypertension. So what are the common presentation for pulmonary hypertension? They are very non-specific symptoms and include exertional dyspnea, fatigue, weakness, chest pain, lightheadedness, syncope, less frequently cough. Initially, these symptoms are induced by exertion, but later in a stage, the disease when progress, it occurs at rest also. Due to non-specific nature of presenting symptom as well as lack of awareness, appreciation of pH in the medical community, the diagnosis of pH is often delayed. These are the physical findings: raised second heart sound, right ventricular heat, JVP distension, hepatojugular reflex, ascites, hepatomegaly, splenomegaly can be seen, edema, TR and PR murmurs, and S3 gallops. Now coming to the one case. A 44-year-old woman with hypertension with complaint of progressive dyspnea for last 6 months only. She reports having dyspnea when walking up the stairs, despite being physically active prior to this experiencing dyspnea. She also reports fatigue and occasional dizziness. She used to smoke but quit about 10 years ago. No history of cough, wheezing, autopnea, and palpitation. Her medical history is otherwise remarkable. These are the physical laboratory findings. All were within the normal limits like hemoglobin, blood sugar, and other parameters. Her BP was 130 by 80. Body mass index was 28 kilometer per meter square, kilogram per meter square. No evidence of peripheral edema, auscultation, breath sounds normal, heart sounds are normal. Only on ECG unremarkable except for non-specific ST wave changes. A chest X-ray and PFT was normal. So my question is this. What is the most possible diagnosis? After pH is a diagnosis of exclusion, so I have to exclude all the causes of which are given in the options like acute pulmonary embolism, heart failure, COPD, and PH. Patient not belong to acute pulmonary embolism because patient is having dyspnea for last 6 months. Heart failure, there is no sign, symptom, and other parameters are normal, so no evidence of heart failure. COPD, she quits smoking and her PFT is normal. And other things are, age is also not so much. So COPD is also excluded. So I just want to highlight here is the pH, PAH could be the possibility for this patient, the most possible diagnosis for this patient, because this is a diagnosis exclusion. We have to exclude all the causes of dyspnea. My next question is about what should arouse the suspicion of pH in this patient. So her prior history of smoking, her history of hypertension, her symptom of fatigue and dizziness. No, these symptoms are not provide the suspicion of. So that common cause of dyspnea have been ruled out. So first thing, whenever you see the patient of one, explain dyspnea, first to rule out the common causes of dyspnea, then again further proceed for the diagnosis of PH. It must be, it could be the PH. So delay in diagnosis of PH, as I earlier told you, it is a very important factor for the prognosis and management of the pulmonary hypertension. This has been shown in the multiple registry registry with a medium delay of about 2 years in 21% of the pulmonary hypertension. The French registry show there are about 27 months of delay, revealed in the other very famous and common registry for the pulmonary hypertension, 33 months in the United States, and Australia registry showed there are about 47 months of delay in pulmonary hypertension diagnosis. So, diagnosis is very challenging for PH. So, we have one good tool for screening is transthoracic echocardiography. It is the most important non-invasive tool, but still right heart catheterization remains a mandatory to establish the diagnosis. It is a gold standard. This is a, I have taken this slide from the 2015 ESCRS guideline. So I'm just highlighting the feature of pulmonary hypertension on the basis of EK. So my most common, most sensitive parameter for this echo is TR velocity. Whenever we see the peak tricuspid regurgitation velocity more than 3.4 meter per second, and there is no need for the presence of other echo PS signs. So there are high probability of pulmonary hypertension. Then we can go ahead with double right heart catheterization in those patients. But whenever patient has a TR velocity less than 2.8 or not measurable, then there is a, and there is a no other signs of PH, then there is a low probability. And in between, the patient lie in an intermediate group. So these are the probability criteria of pulmonary hypertension, low, intermediate, high probability. Now coming to the management. PH management is moving forward the use of combination therapy in respiratory field, in the cardiology field. There are a lot of combination therapy, like in COPD and asthma, we are using a combination inhaler therapy. Like in hypertension, we are using a combination hypertensive therapy. In heart failure, we are using. So now, therapy combination treatment in the picture now. So better management of stress is early diagnosis. First, you stratify your patient on the basis of criteria, combination, then start with the combination therapy. And when patient not respond to combination, then escalation. There is one more option to starting with the escalation therapy, like triple or quadruple combination therapy also. This is a very important slide. I think it is a visible, but it is a very complex slide. And this is a very important on the basis of what, when we diagnose the PH, first to identify the risk, stratify your patient. On the three strata, this guideline prescribes only three strata and four strata risk stratification classification. So on the basis of this, there are 10 values have been given, like sign and symptom of heart failure, progression of disease, WHO function classification of PS, 6-minute walk test, and cardiopulmonary exercise testing, borderline BNP and anti-proBNP test, echocardiography, and cardiac MRI also, and hemodynamic means right heart catheterization. There are a lot of parameters have been given. I can explain only two or three, like 6-minute walk test. If your patient is having 165 meter or less than 165 meter of 6-minute walk distance, it comes under the high risk of category. Your PVR and BNP values are if more than 800 and more than 1100 in anti-proBNP, if your patient comes under the high risk of category. So after categorization, you can identify what kind of management to be given in this patient. These, so 30 years ago, no treatment for PH. 20 years ago, only one treatment for PH. Today, only we have a dozen of drugs for management of PH. And REVEAL registry showed that improved survival from 2.8 years to approximately 9 years after the diagnosis. There are three target therapy pathways in the PH: prostacyclin pathway, nitric oxide pathway, and endothelin pathway. In the prostacyclin pathway, we have iloprost, entriprostinil, and selexipag. We have an oral prostacyclin with us now, is a selexipag. Nitric oxide pathway, we have sildenafil, tadalafil, and riociguat. Riociguat belongs to the soluble gonadotropin stimulator. And endothelin pathway, we have bosentan, ambrisentan, and mesentan. So first therapy was developed in 1996, epoprostenol. After that, so many of years, we have a lot of therapies with us for pulmonary hypertension. So early is better, in every disease. So in same as in PH also, early is better. So early intervention gives no functional impairment and prolongation of life. Late intervention leads to progressive remodeling and right heart failure. These are evidences for upfront combination therapy like Ambition trial, Italy trial, Teton trial, and Sitbon and Menger. There are various studies for this combination therapy. In 2015, ACRS also recommended for Amrisentan, Tadalafil as a first combination therapy, and it has a group 1B recommendation in those patients who is having WHO functional class 3 kind of presentation, and other ERA and phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors got the recommendation of 2AC. So this is a slide about risk stratification in medical therapy of pulmonary hypertension. Whenever a patient who is a new patient without any treatment is coming to us, and we diagnose as a case of pulmonary hypertension confirmed by the expert, and we did not do any non-vasoreactive test was not performed, then we have applied the risk stratification criteria for those patients, which was I have shown you in 2022 guideline. If patient comes under the lower intermediate risk, we can immediately start initial oral combination therapy. If patient belongs to high risk group, we can start with the dual or triple combination therapy, including the prostacycline analog. Then after 3 to 6 months, every PH patient should be followed by after 3 to 6 months by different 4 strata class risk stratification like WHO functional class, 6-minute boxes, and NT-proBNP. On the basis of this, we can again classify these patients into low, intermediate, and high risk. If patient belongs to low risk, then continue the same treatment. If patient belongs to high risk, we can add a sequencing, selexipag, or other combination, other therapies to those patients. So this is a recommendation from ACRS 2020 guideline. Recommendation for initial oral drug combination therapy for patient with idiopathic heritable or drug-associated pulmonary arterial hypertension without any comorbidity, cardiopulmonary comorbidities. The recommendation said that initial combination with amrisentan, tadalafil is as a class 1B recommendation. An initial combination therapy with macitentan and tadalafil also recommended, and they have a same recommendation of 1B. So these two drugs can be used for the upfront combination therapy in our patients.
2 minutes more, please.
So these are the slides of the dosing of amrisentan doses 5 mg, 10 mg, and macitentan 10 mg and, for managing our patients. So PH is an incurable disease and may progress silently even on the days when the patient feels fine. 22% of the patient in Britain trial and Seraphin, 32 patients in Seraphin trial and 29% in Ambition trial. It means 22 to 32% of PH patient progress despite dual therapy. So this is the Ambition trial in which 18 to 75 years of age patients were enrolled from class 1 PAH, and it has shown that 18% of the participants have very less outcome in comparison to monotherapy and dual therapy. They have higher risk of progression in the disease process. This is the OPTIMA trial about the macitentan and tadalafil. They showed that about at the 16 week when we performed the right heart catheterization, overall pulmonary vascular rest is reduced by 47% by combination therapy. This is a Teton trial which showed the selexipag, macitentan and tadalafil combination, but it doesn't fit the primary outcome criteria. So this is not recommended by this 2022 guideline as an upfront therapy, upfront selexipag, macitentan, tadalafil combination for management of PH. But it can be added as a sequential way for those patients who are still on a high risk and not responding to those drugs. Now, suggested assessment and timing for follow-up to our patient. Every patient should be followed at every 3 to 6 months on the basis of 6-minute walk test, blood testing, NT-proBNP, ECG, echocardiography, ABG, and cardiopulmonary exercise testing if we have, and right heart catheterization. So my take-home points are: suspect, diagnose, and treat early. Stepwise approach to optimize risk stratification is a key. Current practice guidelines for the treatment of PH propose a treatment algorithm according to the patient risk factor. A more aggressive approach improves survival in PH. Data support the rationale for targeting multiple pathways in PH. upfront dual or triple combination therapy is recommended to improve outcome as per risk stratification criteria. Celexipag is a novel orally available highly selective prostacyclin receptor agonist with us now from the Griffon trial data showed very promising data from Griffon trial. These are the my contribution to pulmonary hypertension from our department. Thank you.